Good morning. And welcome to Water of Life Lutheran Church. We're happy to have all of you worshiping with us this morning as we continue with our Sunday Lenten series on crush. Today we see that shortcuts are crushed by determination as the religious leaders in Jerusalem want Jesus to take a shortcut by leaving Jerusalem, but he is determined to stay there because he knows that is the way to the cross. We begin our worship by singing hymn 652, which is our theme song, as it were, for the first few Sundays of Lent, as we sing, Lord, have mercy. going to begin with the invocation on page 172. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment, both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the Kyrie, Lord have mercy, which will then be followed by the prayer of the day as we do not sing the Gloria during the season of Lent. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you see that we have no power to defend ourselves. Guard and keep us both outwardly and inwardly from all adversities that may happen to the body and all evil thoughts that may assault and hurt the soul. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our first scripture lesson for today is taken from Jeremiah chapter 26. Jeremiah was concerned for the salvation of God's people. Therefore, even in the face of death, he was determined to preach a call to repentance. We read, when Jeremiah had finished saying everything the Lord had commanded him to say to all the people, then the priests, the prophets, and all the people seized him and said, you must die. Why do you prophesy in the name of the Lord that this house would be like Shiloh and that the city will be desolate with no one living here? All the people crowded around Jeremiah in the house of the Lord. When the officials of Judah heard about these things, they came up from the king's house to the house of the Lord and sat in the entrance of the new gate of the Lord's house. Then the priests and the prophets said to the officials and to all the people, this man deserves the sentence of death because he has been prophesying against this city, as you heard with your own ears. Then Jeremiah said to all the officials and to all the people, the Lord sent me to prophesy against this house and against this city all the things that you have heard. Now reform your ways and your actions and obey the Lord your God. Then the Lord will relent and not bring about the disaster he has pronounced against you. But as for me, look, I am in your hands. Do with me whatever seems good and right in your eyes. But you can be certain of this. If you put me to death, you will bring innocent blood on yourselves and on this city and on those who live here. For it is true that the Lord has sent me to you to speak all these words in your hearing. The word of the Lord. We join in singing Psalm 42. Our second scripture reading is taken from St. Paul's letter to the Christians in the city of Philippi, the third chapter. Being a follower of Jesus means that our path in life will resemble his. The path to heaven inevitably includes crosses. So Paul encourages us to follow Jesus' example of determination. We hear Paul's words. Brothers, join together in imitating me and in paying attention to those who are walking according to the pattern we gave you. To be sure, many walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. I told you about them often, and now I am saying it while weeping. Their end is destruction, their God is their appetite, and their glory is in their shame. They are thinking only about earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven. We are eagerly waiting for a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. By the power that enables him to subject all things to himself, he will transform our humble bodies to be like his glorious body. So then, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, in this way, keep standing firm in the Lord, my dear friends. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please rise. We join in singing the gospel acclamation for the season of Lent.
Thank you.
Our gospel lesson and our sermon text for this morning is taken from Luke chapter 13. The Pharisees offer a shortcut to safety, but Jesus was determined to continue down the path he was on for us and for our salvation. We read, "In that very hour, some Pharisees came to him and said, 'Leave and go away from here, because Herod wants to kill you.' He said to them, 'Go tell that fox, look, I am going to drive out demons and heal people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will reach my goal. And nevertheless, I must go on my way today and tomorrow and the next day, because it cannot be that a prophet would be killed outside Jerusalem.' Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those sent to her. How often I have wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you are not willing. Look, your house is left you desolate. I tell you, you will not see me until the time comes when you will say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" The gospel of the Lord. The congregation may be seated, and we invite the young children to come forward for the children's devotion. So I don't know if you've heard this, but there is a war going on over in Ukraine with Russia. Russia has invaded Ukraine, and they want then to shoot and kill the president of Ukraine. That's not a very nice thing to do. Well, our government in the United States reached out to the president of Ukraine and said, "You know, we can come over with an airplane and rescue you and bring you to safety here." And that president said, "I don't need a ride, I need bullets." Okay, he needs bullets because he's going to stay and fight. He's determined he's going to stay there. Well, that's very similar to what we heard Jesus say. The religious leaders, the Pharisees, come to Jesus and say that King Herod wants Jesus dead. Now, we don't know if the Pharisees were making that story up just to get rid of Jesus, or if King Herod really wanted Jesus dead. But do you remember what Jesus did? Did he run away? What did he do? Yeah, he stayed. He was determined to stay because that's what needed to happen, because he knew he wasn't going to be killed by Herod. He was going to be killed on the cross later. What are you thinking that you want to be when you grow up? Do you have any ideas? Nothing yet? Well, let's say that you want to be an artist or a doctor or an electrician. And as you're studying to do those things, a lot of problems come in your way. And yet you are determined that nothing's going to stop you from doing what you want to do, being an artist or a doctor or an electrician. You're determined, and you're going to do that no matter what. And that's Jesus in the gospel lesson, isn't it? He's determined to be our Savior no matter what. And for that today, we thank him. Let's pray about that. Lord Jesus, we see today that you were determined to be our Savior, that nothing, not even a king, not even religious leaders who are trying to get you to leave them alone, were going to stop you from your determined path of going to the cross for us and for our salvation. And for that today, we simply thank you. Thank you that you were determined that no matter what, you are going to go to the cross to pay for our sins and then rise from the dead for our resurrection. Lord, today we give you thanks and praise and glory. Amen. We continue with the congregation singing our hymn of the day.
Thank you.
Apostle Paul tell us this morning? But our citizenship is in heaven. We eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. What am I going to do with you? If you're a parent, you've said those words. If you're a child, or if you've ever been a child, you've heard those words said to you. They are words of exasperation. They are words that are said when all other words have been ignored. They are both words of frustration and they're words of love. What am I going to do with you? Those are really the words that Jesus says to the inhabitants of Jerusalem in our gospel lesson today. This is Jesus' lament because he loves the citizens of Jerusalem. This is the place where the big events of the Old Testament have taken place. It is where Abraham sacrifices his son Isaac. This is where God reveals his glory to his chosen people. Jerusalem is David's royal city. It is the place where his son Solomon builds the temple to the Lord. The name Jerusalem means city of peace, but the inhabitants of Jerusalem are anything but peaceful. This is the place where generations of inhabitants have set up idols inside the temple to false gods. When they did offer sacrifices to the true God, they were often worthless and meaningless sacrifices, just going through the motions. These are people who have rejected God and his love. Inside the walls of Jerusalem, they have killed and stoned the prophets. And now they're getting ready to do the same thing to God's own son. Jerusalem, Jerusalem. You can hear the sorrow in Jesus' voice. He is lamenting over these inhabitants. He is frustrated because he loves them, but they don't love him in return. He is exasperated because he teaches, but they don't learn. He is frustrated because he is preaching and they refuse to listen. He's discouraged because he rebukes, but they don't repent. What is he going to do with them? They are his fuzzy little yellow chicks. He loves them despite their opposition, despite their obstinance, despite their rebellion. He wants to take them underneath his protective wings to forgive them, heal them, and love them. But they were not willing. How sad those words are. Chicks who are rejecting their protecting mother, running all around the barnyard, exposing themselves to the danger of predators instead of being safe and secure underneath the wings of their mother. I don't know if you've ever seen a chicken hawk. A chicken hawk that's either flying in the air or resting on a branch of a tree looking down for its prey. Somehow, God has given mother hens a sixth sense so that they can sense when there is danger out there. And when they sense that chicken hawk nearby, then she fiercely squawks, calling all of her chicks from coming out from the barnyard to come under the protection of her wings. And when the chicken hawk dives down, the mother hen is too big to be prey and the chicks are too safe to be seized. Except for that one chick that thought that he knew better, that he could go off on his own, that he didn't want to listen to his mother. He wanted to go off and do his own thing. And now what has happened to him? He's hawk lunch. Does that mean that the mother's wings did not offer protection? No. It meant that the chick forfeited what was offered and then suffered the consequences. Jerusalem, Jerusalem. Jesus says those same words to us today because we too are fuzzy little yellow chicks scurrying away from the safety of Jesus' wings. What is Jesus going to do with us? Jesus wants to save us, but so often we live as if we don't want to be saved. We overwork, overextend, overindulge, not realizing the danger. We allow the wisdom of the world to permeate us instead of listening to the wisdom of God in His Word. Our God is our belly. We glory in our shame. We revel in our filth. We yearn for the earthly things that Paul talks about with the Philippians, and then we forfeit the heavenly things. We allow the church to become more like the world. Instead of influencing the world, to become more like the church. We hear the word of God, and then we live as if we didn't. That's why I love the powerful words of our opening hymn. And it's why we're singing that hymn five times for the first five Sundays of Lent. Because I want you to know that melody so well that you can start focusing on the words. Words that weren't written by a Lutheran, but they are certainly Lutheran words. For what we have done and left undone, we fall on your countless mercies. For sins that are known and those unknown, we call on your name so holy. For envy and pride, for closing our eyes, for scorning our very neighbor. In thought, word, and deed, we'd failed you, our King. How deeply we need a Savior. For hearts that are cold, for seizing control, for scorning our very Maker. In thought, word, and deed, we failed you, our King. How deeply we need a Savior. How deeply we need the Lord's mercy as a call to repentance. How deeply we need Christ's mercy as our brother and our Savior. How deeply we need the Lord's mercy as a mother calling the chicks to repentance. Chicks that like to scatter and run. Friends, could it be that we are having so many problems in our world, in our culture, and in our own homes because we continue to wander away from God's word and His will for our lives? Could it be that we are struggling in our marriages because we're pulling away from God? I have yet to find a married couple that is really struggling in their marriage if both spouses are humble. That they are putting the other spouse ahead of themselves and they're trusting the Lord and His leadership. Usually what happens is when there is problems in marriage, one or both of the marriage partners are pulling away from the Lord, and then that means they're going to start pulling away from each other. Or why is your relationship with your boyfriend or girlfriend going so terribly? Well, maybe it's because you're sleeping with that boyfriend and girlfriend, that you're acting as you're married, even though you're not married. You want God's blessings on your relationship, but then you're doing the exact opposite of what God promises to bless in marriage. And you felt it. These past 2 years have been hard on everyone. There seems to be super high levels of stress. Our relationships are strained. We have experienced disconnections with everyone. And everyone seems grumpy and on edge all the time. And this is affecting you, but think about how it also affects our called workers. If you're someone that looks weekly at the Wells call list for pastors and teachers, it is a sad and disheartening reality that almost every week there are teachers that are resigning their call. Now, pastors are not resigning their calls, but think about this has been on the pastors, that so many pastors these last few years have been overworked. They've been depressed. They've been hammered. They've been hammered in the way they dealt with the pandemic, that they dealt with it this way. So this group of people hammered them. They dealt with the pandemic this way, and then this group of people hammered them the other way. And then members have absented themselves from the body of Christ. Satan is digging his talons into all of us. People in the pews, the teachers in the classrooms, the pastors in the pulpits. What is Jesus going to do with people like us? We couldn't blame Jesus if he just let us go. If he allowed us to stew in our distress, to depart to our destruction, to be disciplined for our disobedience against him, our defiance of God's messengers, or for the messenger's disinterest in God's word and sacraments. We can't blame Jesus if he said to us, look, your house is left to you desolate. You will not see me again. But Jesus doesn't do that. He doesn't desire to be apart from us. He desires to be with us. He desires to show us mercy. He will not abandon you. He knows that you, like the inhabitants of the City of Peace, want to tear him to pieces. He understands that inside of every one of you is a sinful nature that is then by nature stubborn and obstinate, rebellious and unrepentant. And that's why in his mercy he says, how often I have wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. He says, you will not see me until the time when you will hear me say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In other words, Jesus is always hovering over us. His love is always nearby to us. He will never turn you away as a helpless little yellow chick when you finally realize that you are a fuzzy little helpless chick, that you are helpless on your own. When you realize that you need to be done with the lies of the devil, when you are bruised and beaten, when you are sorrowful and repentant, then Jesus lifts up his wings so that you can scurry under. Or as the words of the psalm say, there we can hide in the shadow of his wings. There we are safe under the shelter of his wings. There under his wings we find refuge and can sing for joy. And there under his wings we can sing, for what you have done, your life of love you perfectly lived, we praise you. Though tempted and tried, you fixed your eyes, you finished the work God gave you. And there on a tree, a king among thieves, you bled for a world's betrayal. You loved to the end our merciful friend, how pure and forever faithful. Fellow chicks, there is danger all around us. Some of this danger you can see, some of it you can't see. We're living in a world where you're hearing threats about a third world war. But there's also threats in our own nation. Threats that now we are trying to raise our children and our grandchildren in a culture that can't even tell what a woman is anymore. Where we have the President of the United States in his State of the Union speech calling for more abortions, more murder of the unborn, that he then calls for more maternal rights, more maternal health care. Really, how sick is that to call abortion maternal health care? We live in a world where our own self is against us. Our sinful nature is warring against our sanctified, baptized side, where we have the devil and his demons sitting on our shoulders, whispering lies into our ears. And yet we have a Savior who moved himself out from underneath the protection of his Father's wings in heaven to put himself under all of this evil of our world, our culture, our sinful natures, the devil and his demons. He endured the wrath of God for our stubbornness and unrepentance. He allowed the people he loved to betray him, deny him, spit on him, pull out the whiskers in his beard, to crucify him. He let the devil have his way with him. The old evil foe, the prowling lion, the ancient serpent, the red seven-headed dragon. The devil defeated Adam and all of his countless children by laying out a bait that none of us could refuse. And so Jesus laid out a bait that the devil could not refuse. Because how could the devil ever refuse the opportunity to kill the Son of God?
And so the one who baits us into sin was himself baited to his own destruction. Or as you'll hear me say in a little bit before, the words of institution, that he who overcame us by a tree would in turn by a tree be overcome. There on the cross, the second Adam crushed the ancient serpent's head. There he died protecting the young. I read a story about a young boy named Ike who was over at his grandfather's house when lightning struck the hen house, setting it on fire, and all the chickens inside died. When the fire was out and everything cooled down, Ike and his grandfather were picking through the rubble, throwing away the dead chickens they found. Ike picked up one dead hen, and underneath scurried four chicks that ran away, that they were kept alive from the blazing fire under the insulation of their mother's wings. Jesus died so that we might remain living. He kept us safe from and insulated under his wings, insulated from the fires of hell. But the difference between Jesus and that hen is that hen stayed dead. But Jesus rose again from the dead. And the first thing Jesus did upon his resurrection was to march down to hell. He ripped the gates off of Hades, and then he preached a sermon of victory to the devil, his demons, and all those who had rejected him as their Savior. Then he rose from the dead and stripped the grave of its power. And now Jesus continues to come to you, calling, gathering, and inviting you. So quit running away from him. Stop refusing his word. Stop rejecting his messengers. Instead, come to the Lord. Take refuge under his wings. Keep reading and listening to God's word to relieve your stress. Keep hearing the forgiveness that you so desperately need, hearing those words of forgiveness and the words of absolution. Gather together with your fellow baptized believers around the font. Continue to receive the strength of the Lord's Supper with your brothers and sisters in Christ. My dear fuzzy little yellow chicks, wash, eat, drink, and hear. There is no danger here. There is no reason to fear the foe in these sacred things. Because this is exactly what you need so that Jesus can put together your broken marriage, so that he can heal your messed up relationships, so that he can reorder your misplaced priorities, so that he can use his called workers to encourage you, and so that he can use you to encourage his called workers. He can love you, protect you, forgive you. Repent, return, and find refuge. That's what Jesus wants to do with you. Amen. Please rise. Again, as St. Paul says, my brothers and sisters whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, in this way keep standing firm in the Lord, my dear friends. Amen. Let us join in confessing our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed on page 180. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. Heavenly Father, we see how many still walk as enemies of the cross of Christ and face destruction. Make known your mercies in Christ, that they may repent and become citizens of your kingdom. Protect your people from their evil intentions, and grant that we would follow the example of the apostles who willingly suffered wrong to make Jesus known. Remember the households of this congregation, O Lord. Provide help and companionship to those who live alone, and foster love between husbands and wives, parents and children, that our homes would not be places to worship our bellies, glory in shame, or set our minds on earthly things. Instead, make their houses a refuge where your love is reflected, and parents bring their children to your house to worship you as their refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Remember our nation and those you have placed in authority, O Lord. Give them wisdom and integrity. Thwart their efforts when they create laws that support Satan's will. Instead, lead our leaders to judge justly, govern wisely, and create laws that reflect your holy will. Also, Lord, we ask you that you would bless our congregation as we have called Pastor Isaac Cherney to serve as our pastor of InReach. And we also ask you to bless us as we're going to be placing calls in a week and a half for teachers at Wisconsin Lutheran School. We ask you to give us the right pastor and teachers in your time for the goal of growing your ministry here at Water of Life and Wisconsin Lutheran School. And also remember this household of faith, O Lord, and gather us together in your sanctuary as a hen gathers her brood under her wings. Unite us in true confession of your word, sincere repentance for our sins, and joyful confidence in your Son's body and blood for our forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. And we continue to worship our God and support his ministry here at Water of Life with our offerings. During the offering, we ask that you would please sign the card that is in your pews. Please rise. And we continue with the preface for the sacrament on page 183. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. That we should at all times and all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, who brought the gift of salvation to all people by his death on the tree of the cross, so that the devil, who overcame us by a tree, would in turn by a tree be overcome. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Thank you. Lord God, you are worthy to receive thanks and praise from all people. You created the world and all who live in it, and in your mercy you saved us. We give thanks to you for the grace of your Son, Jesus Christ. Though in very nature God, he took the nature of a servant and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. He offered himself as a sacrifice for sin and redeemed us from its curse and penalty. He rescued us from the terrors of death and restored eternal life with you. He conquered our enemies and gained for us the kingdom of grace and glory. Bless us as we receive your Son's body and blood, and lead us to remember his suffering, death, and resurrection. Forgive our sins and fill us with the hope of new life in heaven. Hear our praise and receive our thanks as we worship you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink of it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
Now may the true body and true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in the true Christian faith and the life everlasting. You know, peace with God. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Please rise. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
We give you thanks, O Lord, for the foretaste of the heavenly banquet you have given us in the sacrament. Through this gift, you have fed our faith, nourished our hope, and strengthened our love. By your Spirit, help us to live as your holy people until that day when you will receive us as your guests at the wedding supper of the Lamb, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We close our worship by singing hymn 853, I'm But a Stranger Here.
$5. anybody wants to go. I'll drive if they want to carpool.
There you go. You got a chaperone.